Merci beaucoup.
De rien. Puis ça vous permet de vous réchauffer, hein, le fait d'appeler. So I was asked to, or I was proposed, or I proposed to do it in English. It's up to you. You're all comfortable with it? Some would be maybe more comfortable in English. So what I'd like to present is another way of doing innovation. So for most of you, probably innovation is about technology innovation, developing new technologies, new products. But there is another side of it, and this is what I would like to present to you. I was recruited, so I will introduce myself. I've been at Airbus for 35 plus years. I've been a great part of my career involved in research and technology. Up to 2013, I was the head of IADES Innovation Works, which was the corporate research organization of IADES, the mother company of Airbus, something that I created in 2006. And between 2013 and now, I've been developing the other side of innovation, which is business-driven innovation. So it's not about developing technologies, it's about using existing technologies to develop new ways of using those technologies, developing services for people, developing services for passengers, but also for the crew members in the cabin or the maintenance operators. Is it okay for the sound? It's, yeah. I will try to modify it. Okay, I was said that I need to touch it to make it well. So I don't know, I guess you had presentations from people from Airbus during the year. So maybe I will go rapidly on the first slides, which are about Airbus commercial in the overall aviation context. And I will go rapidly to the main topic of the day, which is innovation. And I will try to illustrate what I will say with concrete examples. Some of those stories have already been made public. Two or three of them are still confidential to Airbus, so I will not say, I will not disclose great secrets, and I will not the slides corresponding to those stories will not be in the final pack, which will be distributed. Are you aware of those figures? If you think that it's not useful that I come back on it, I will skip them. It's just to speak about the importance today of aviation in the global economy. 3.6, it's close to 4 billion passengers now yearly. 63 million jobs4 billion passengers, yes, I said it right, yeah. 63 million jobs. A GDP which is corresponding to some countries in the world. So it's something which is very important. And what is of most importance is the growth. So we have a continuous growth of the traffic. We had a continuous growth of the traffic over the last years, and it continues. It's the traffic is doubling every 15 years, and this is why we have this target to very stringent target for reducing CO2 emissions, noise, and so on by 2050. Because in 2050, we will have twice as many aircraft as we had in 2005, and we target to reduce, to cut even with a double sized fleet. We want to cut the emissions by a ratio of 2, which means that in average an aircraft should emit 4 times less emissions than in 2005. Aircraft division is only a part of Airbus. You know that in 2017, Airbus commercial aircraft, which was originally called only Airbus, has integrated the mother company, which was called the IADES, and then Airbus Group. And now it's only one. So the new setup of the company is one big company called Airbus developing and selling commercial aircraft with two subsidiaries, one which is dedicated to defense and space products and the other one dedicated to helicopters. Overall, we have a workforce of 136,000 people. An order book which make a lot of people dream in the world, 1,000 billion. So it's a very big one. We have about 10 years of order book. And annual revenue, when EADS was created in 2000, the annual revenues were 20 billion. So we have tripled the revenues over the last 17 years. In it, Airbus Commercial is representing the major part of the annual review revenue, 46 out of 64, but only 55,000 employees over the total of 136. It's due to the fact that we are subcontracting and buying a lot on the aircraft side. 10 years backlog, I already said it. Something also which is important is the number of operators, 400 operators, so 400 airlines or lessors buying our aircraft. We are global. The market, the aviation, is something which is also very specific to aviation. Aviation is a worldwide market for certification, for a lot of things. So we need to be global. Historically, we have 11 production sites, mostly in Europe. You know the story of Airbus. Airbus was, for the commercial aircraft part, was a GIE, Groupement d'Intérêt Économique, between France, Germany, Spain, and UK until 2001, before it was integrated. And we historically have all those sites. And any attempt in the past to try to make it more rational was confronted to some political resistance first, and second, honestly, to move activities from one factory to another factory because of the investment it represents is something which is also very costly, not always easy to justify with a business case. So global presence, mostly driven by the commercial aspects, but more and more we are also looking globally for talents and for lower cost, I would say. You know that for a long period of time we've been confronted to a dollar to euro ratio, which was not very favorable. It was, today it's okay, but it works, yes. For a period of time, it was not favorable, and it pushed us to look for lower cost countries. But today, it's more looking for resources. So you're lucky enough to be in a domain which is still with a lot of possibilities of development in the future, both technically and commercially. But there are a lot of countries also who are moving fast in that. So you know that we have opened a final assembly line in China, Tianjin, and also in the US, in Mobile, Alabama. And we are also more global with regard to the engineering capabilities. So we have an engineering center in Bangalore. We have one in China. We have two in the US, so we are more and more global also with regard to the engineering footprint. Airbus is a place, if you want to come into Airbus, one important thing will be diversity of origins. So we have more than 100 different nationalities. So it's linked to the global presence that we have, but it's also something that is wanted by the management of the organization. It brings a lot of diversity in the culture, so it helps us in selling aircraft everywhere in the world to better understand as well what are the specific needs in the different places in the world. And we have a specific attention also which is paid, and I'm just looking at the room today, at gender diversity. We are not really well positioned. The sound is awful. Huh? We are not really well positioned in France with regard to the number of ladies doing studies, technical scientific studies. But at Airbus, we are really trying to encourage as much as we can. We even have some specific initiatives, starting very with very young students. The aircraft family. So the cash cow of Airbus is a single L. And mostly with a new development with the NEO, even if we had difficulties in deliveries due to the availability of engines, the A320 NEO is really selling very well. It represents more than 60% of the order book in this segment. The 330, which was developed in, so the 320 was developed, it was one of my first work when I entered Airbus in 1982. It was developed in the 80s, so it may be seen as an old aircraft, but it's much younger than its main competitor, the 737, which was developed one decade before. The 330 was developed in the 90s, so it's also seen as an old aircraft. I would say that the 330 and 320 in terms of basic configurations are very close in terms of technologies. And we have the new program, so the 380 with the certification in 2006, with a lot of new things on board, including a center wing box, which is fully in composite, and the 350, which is the most recent one, which is, it's not a full composite aircraft, but the level of the ratio of composite parts in it is very high, and there are a lot of new things in this aircraft. But the 330 is still selling pretty well. We have sold more than 1,000, so it's not a bad thing. Just for you, as an anecdote, when I was working on the 320 in the 80s, we were the previous programs were things like Concorde, 16 aircraft, Super Caravelle. It was also a handful of aircraft. It was very small numbers. So we were dreaming of selling 600 aircraft, 600, and we are today above 13,000. So just to give you an indication, so this obviously we benefited from the growth of the traffic, but this aircraft is really a killer on the market. Well, this is, I will not comment, I already said it. So I will pass rapidly. Just if we look at history of innovation in our industry, there were different periods. Obviously, the first period was to make it fly. The pioneers just do it. The times of Clément Ader, of Blériot, all those people. And then with the development after the First World War of the, with the development of the first commercial flight, the first commercial flight was in 1914. It was over a lake in the U.S. and there was one passenger paying a fortune to, like today we would have passengers for going in space for 3 minutes. It was the equivalent at that time. But really, between the First and the Second World War, the traffic started to develop, and very rapidly the key point was to improve safety. So it was do it safely. And then we had the period of Concorde. The development of Concorde started in the mid 50s, around 1956, if I remember well, even if the first flight was in 1969. And the challenge was to fly faster. And you know the performance of Concorde flying at Mach 2. It was really a very, very nice aircraft, but commercially, probably it did not come at the right time. It was designed with engines which were derived from military engines. And if well, you were you you are much too young, but in 1974 we had the first oil crisis with an increase of the oil price, and immediately the economics of Concorde were going down because it's burning a lot of fuel. This added to the fact that the Americans decided not to develop their own supersonic aircraft. Really killed the commercial development of Concorde. So we are now in a period, and we've been in that period for 40 years now, where the because the traffic is developing, because more and more people want to travel around the world, but at a relatively low cost. The key point is to make it affordable. So make it affordable means make the air travel affordable to a big number of people. You probably find, you know, that you can find now today tickets at 30 euros. I think that Paris, New York in Concorde was at the time 30,000 francs. Bon, it gives for the one who knows the conversion between francs and euros, it gives you an idea of the difference. So the innovation at Airbus is a never-ending story. When Airbus started in the late 60s, or more surely beginning of 70s, Airbus was not existing, so we were starting from scratch, and we had to find our place in front of companies like Boeing, but also McDonnell Douglas and Lockheed Martin. So they were already players in the Western world. And there was this crazy idea of developing a twin-aisle mid-range aircraft. And this was the A300. It was unexpected, I would say. In this type of range, it was mostly a single-aisle aircraft. And then there was the full fly-by-wire on the A320, which was prepared by the Concorde, the first complete double-decker aircraft with the A380, and the advanced use of composite materials on the 350. Today, the innovation is mostly driven by the evolution of the business, and I've put there some key elements of this evolution. The first one, I already mentioned it, is the continuous growth of the traffic. So you see, if you compare this number, 32,000 new aircraft required by 2035, compared to the aircraft we sold today, it's twice the number. Obviously, this has to be shared between us and our competitors, but it's something which is key. Another element which is key with regard to the development of the traffic is the development of megacities. Development of megacities means, and we believe it means, that you need to increase the capacities of aircraft. There will be, if there is no major evolution or improvement in the air traffic management or in the airport management, there is a certain congestion, in a certain limitation in the number of aircraft that can depart from an airport. So this probably requires higher capacities for the aircraft. And we see it also in the sales of the single L. We sell more and more the A321, which is a long version of the single L, and less of the 318 and 318, by the way, disappeared, 319. So it's airlines are looking for more capacities, but it's also the rationale that we use to say A380 will find its place one day. We hope that one day is before the end of the year, but okay. Megacities also means that air may be a solution for avoiding road congestions. So some of you probably saw the Le Cinquième Élément. I don't know the English name for this film from Luc Besson. But if the roads are congested, why not use the third dimension? So there are lots of ideas around urban air mobility. In Francazal, there is a small company called EVA, developing a flying car or drone able to transport people. We are ourselves at Airbus developing a project, Vaiana, and City Airbus. So the development of mega cities is also an opportunity to develop new new products for the urban applications. Another evolution is the development of services. So we have the existing fleet is bigger and bigger, and the passengers are less and less accepting that their flight is delayed or cancelled. So we have to make sure that the aircraft is not grounded unexpectedly or not even delayed. So the pressure to avoid any last minute issue on an aircraft is bigger and bigger. And it's even worse in Europe, where if your flight is delayed by more than 3 hours or cancelled, you can get money back from the airline, compensation. EasyJet calculated that if things were going wrong, it may reach up to 85 million euros compensation to be given to the passengers in a year. So just if you apply, if everybody, every passenger asks for this compensation, and if they do not improve their statistics with regard to grounding and delays, so it's a major number, 85 million euros, it's a big number. So the development of services is mostly driven by that. So it's so it results in development of predictive maintenance. But it's also driven by the fact that as we have, and I mentioned it, as we have more and more aircraft flying, the need for improving the air traffic control and the need to improve things like situational awareness, so to bring to the aircraft the necessary information to avoid incidents, to avoid accidents, or also to avoid areas where you have severe weather conditions. This need for services on route planning and optimization is also something which is increasing. Another evolution is the evolution of the customer landscape. It was not the case 5 years ago, but today we have one aircraft over two which is sold not to an airline but to a lessor. The lessor is then making the aircraft available for an airline. So this has an impact on the way we design aircraft. So the need for having a low cost reconfiguration of the aircraft when it goes from one end to another end, from an airline to another airline, is something which is important. The residual value of an aircraft is also something which is more and more important. Obviously, we have the development of low-cost companies, which is good news. Most of the single-aisle aircraft, the SU-20s, have been sold recently to low-cost companies. And MROs, so companies involved in maintenance, repair, and overhaul, also because of the increase of the fleet, are more and more important, and they are demanding support, and in fact we abandoned this domain when we sold the Sogerma, but we are back into this business because there is a request from some airlines. They do not want to take care of their maintenance by themselves and they are expecting support from us. And obviously there are new competitors, so Comac is well known, but also Russia is back, and we have in some domains competition with our own suppliers. There may be competition on the MRO in particular with Air France Industry and Lufthansa Technique or Singapore. But it's sometimes also some of our suppliers are dreaming of developing also small aircraft or things which will be dedicated to urban air mobility. So we have a certain number of challenges in ahead of us. The most famous one is in the industrial performance. So I will not comment the press. You know that we have difficulties to deliver what we promised in terms of number of aircraft. I hope that we will do it. So it's because the engines were not available, but it's not only that. So with the increase of the of the sales, we need to increase the deliveries as well. And we need to, I would not say that we were an aircraft company, we were an we are an industrial company, but the ramp up which is required to deliver the aircraft we are selling forces us to go to new approaches which are getting close to the approaches that we find in the automotive industry, so more automation, more robots in the plants and so on. So industrial performance is high on the list of priorities. It goes with the competitiveness. I mentioned that so we have there are newcomers, but globally, if we want to continue to feed our engineering departments and plants, we need to globally improve the way we design and manufacture the aircraft. Customization is a challenge that is put on us by the airlines. So we have at the same time to reduce the cost, deliver more aircraft, but also listen more to the customers who want to customize the aircraft, because this is the way they are differentiating from their on their competitors. Not always easy to, because cost pressure goes into the direction of standards, and customization obviously goes against standards. Development of services requires new competencies. The environmental roadmap is something which is also very high on the agenda. And I think that with the recent presentations, talks of our President Macron, it will not decrease. So we have a very stringent target for 2050 in terms of emissions. And noise, and so CO2 and NOx emissions and noise, and this pressure will not reduce; it will further increase. So we really need to improve that. So environment is obviously first what is delivered by the aircraft itself, but it's also the way we manufacture it. So there are lots of things which are related to some substances, chemical substances, which are not allowed anymore. It's about reducing the energy which is required to manufacture parts and so on. Safety and security, I will not comment on it. It's something which is, it's a must. And urban air mobility, I already mentioned it. So in front of those challenges, we have a certain number of game changers that are coming. Obviously, big data, data analytics is a wonderful opportunity for us. Be it in the plants or on in the domain of development of services, for instance, for predictive maintenance. Automation and robotics for the plants mostly. Autonomy, so we are now officially speaking about single pilot operations or even no pilot operations, so fully autonomous aircraft. Virtual reality, augmented reality, connected objects. I will go rapidly because it's our new materials. Not everything is at the same level, but if we want, the last two aspects are very important. If we want to go to electric flight or hybrid aircraft, obviously we will need new batteries. The ones that are today commercially available do not fit at all with what we need, and new electronics. It's at the same time miniaturized electronics for avionics and so on, but it's also power electronics going with the electric propulsion. At Airbus, innovation goes from incremental development. This is important. We are selling a lot of aircraft, and we need to permanently improve the cabin, the performance of existing aircraft. And we need to be faster, to go faster on the market with new solutions that improve the efficiency for the customers, for the airlines. Whoop. But it's also innovation is also about being disruptive. And for that, over the last 4 years, we have created new vehicles for disruptive innovation. A-Cube in Silicon Valley, which is a place with a kind, it's separated from the mainstream of Airbus, and in A-Cube we can develop new projects like I mentioned Verna, which is a kind of a flying car out of the Airbus processes, out of the procurement processes, out of the all, you forget everything you know from Airbus and you do it from as if you were a startup, but with a little bit more money than a startup. BizLab, startup, it's good. It's a good link to BizLab. So we have created one BizLab here in Toulouse, another one in Hamburg, and a third one in Bangalore. So these are places, so you know probably the accelerators, so it's places where you are welcoming startups and you are helping them to develop their, it's for the initial phase of the development of the startup. Here the idea is to have an hybrid accelerator, so in BizLabs we are welcoming startups from the outside, so real startups I would say, which are selected in an international competition, so it's on internet, and they are co-located without any fence with internal Airbus projects which are managed with on the lean startup model, so we have internal projects managed like startups going together with real startups, and the idea is that having all those people together, you will have a transfer of the mindset of a startupper to Airbus people, but also it's the idea is that we create through the confrontation of the two new ideas for services or for products. FlyUI ideas is something which is it's an open source open crowdsourcing competition for universities, so I guess some teams from Superior are participating, and ID space is the same for internal, so we have a permanent it's kind of electronic ID box, so every employee within Airbus group, the complete group, can post IDs, and they are screened by a few 20 volunteers who are permanently screening this, but we have we are mostly using it on campaigns, so we are organizing specific ID generation campaigns on priorities of the group. With regard to incremental innovation, the best example is probably the A320. I think it was really even if it was, I must say in a way we were at that time challenged by the arrival of the C-Series and Comac with the new engines, but the idea was that instead of developing completely a new aircraft, we had the opportunity to enhance the existing 320 with new engines with a strong impact on the overall efficiency. So incremental innovation is really about that. You take an existing product and you stretch the efficiency, the performance as much as you can. So in that case, we also developed the Sharklets to, even if Boeing did it before, to further improve the drag. But sometimes incremental innovation is just if you have the opportunity to add two rows of seats in an aircraft, which means on a single L, it's 12 seats, it has a very great impact on an airline. So if in the same aircraft with the same overall fuel burn and so on, you had 12 passengers, I can tell you that the airlines are ready to pay a lot for that. So everything which may appear as little things, not very innovative from a technical point of view, like reducing the thickness of the seats and things like that, it has a huge impact on the overall efficiency economics for the airline. So nothing should be, we cannot neglect anything when we are working on incremental innovation. Sometimes it's a little bit more complex with regard to technology. So we have developed with Safran electric taxiing, around 5% of the emissions in average of the aircraft are on ground. And there is a specific need to reduce emissions at ground level. I mean, when we are looked at by the non-governmental organizations or by the authorities, obviously the overall impact of our products on the environment is looked at. But what is specifically on ground is really important in the overall equation, because on top of the CO2 emissions, you may have also small particles and so on. We are, in fact, close to what is required for the automotive industry. So everything we can do to reduce the emissions on ground is important. So we have developed this electric taxiing, which is now offered since Le Bourget this year to the companies. So the first we may say that the first benefit is reduction of emissions. There is a second benefit, which is sometimes placed ranked number one by some airlines, that you do not need the car anymore to for the pushback. So the aircraft becomes autonomous from the airport for the pushback, and this represents for airlines also a major savings in terms of cost of operations, plus the fact that the car is not always there to push the aircraft back. So there are some delays which are linked to that, so it's something which is really very much appreciated. Flight operations, we developed with our colleagues from space and using the exploitation of space data services in the domain of route planning optimization. And this development led to the decision we made beginning of 2000, end of 2015, beginning of 2016, to buy Navtech, which is one of the operators in the domain of services and flight operations. The major one today is JPSN, which is representing 80% of the market, and it's 100% subsidiary of Boeing. And then there were two number two. Lido, which is belonging to Lufthansa Technik, and Navtec, which was a free runner, I would say, and we bought Navtec and we created NavBlue. Incremental development may also be thinking about the way the aircraft are operated, and flight formation or formation flight is it may appear as something crazy when we look at birds flying, and we see that the birds are flying in formation to save energy. But the same can be applied to aircraft. We have demonstrated through flight tests that we, on a single flight, we may have 15% fuel burn reduction for the aircraft flying behind the as number two. But overall, if we can manage to find a proper business model with the different airlines to do it on cross-Atlantic routes, for instance, it might lead also to a 10% fuel burn reduction for this fleet on this specific route. So, and this is not rocket science, it's just the way, well, there are some technical features to be developed, but it's just a way to use the existing aircraft. In the future, we are, and this is important, today it's really a priority. We see the end of what we are getting close to the end of the improvement of conventional thermal engines. With a new generation, we have improved by 15%. We can go up to 20%, but really to make a breakthrough in that domain, we need to completely change. And this is why we've been investing since 2009. The early developments were in 2009 on electric flight, and with a focus on electric hybrid aircraft. So this is a major element of the Airbus roadmap. It's also a major element of the Aerospace Valley roadmap, and we have it's one of our four top priorities. And obviously, Super Aero for the research activities is deeply involved in that. But the plan today is, so we flew with a very small aircraft, the EFAN. Next step is to start making tests with big engines, 2 megawatt engines, to look at all the issues which may be created by the integration of those big electric engines and the power electronics which is required to make it fly. There will be probably an intermediate step where we will have smaller in the range, well, it may be between 20 and I do not want to be too precise, between 20 and 70 passengers that could start entering into service around 2030. But for larger aircraft, it will be 2040 probably. I don't know if we have the sound here. Yeah. It apparently does not work. No, it does not work. Okay, bon. There was a small movie that you can see on YouTube, which is a small story. It has been created by IBM. So you see Mr. Innovation coming, and he is very creative and so on, but he forgot something, which is innovation is also about execution and bringing things to the market. I think it was Steve Jobs saying innovation is when the idea is shipped to a customer, to somebody who will buy it. Another sentence which I loved, an ounce of execution is worth more than a ton of theory. So innovation is really focusing on what will go to the market. So this is why we, during the last 4 years, we pushed a lot on developing a new mindset, new culture. And the idea was at the same time to try to, we have this image of the tugboat moving the big ship in the right direction. So changing the culture of the company, opening more the people to what is happening outside. Our previous technical director, Paul Erenko, was we need to disrupt before being disrupted. So it is really, we cannot wait until somebody comes with another SpaceX, but we have to be the one developing the new thing. So changing the culture, but changing the culture is okay, but you also need to test the theory and practice by yourself. So we have developed at the same time things on the change of culture through a network, so-called Catalyst Network, Innovation Catalyst Network, and also we've been working on projects, new ways of doing innovation to deliver big projects. So the network today, we have within Airbus close to 200 people who have been trained specifically on methods like design thinking, system thinking, lean startup, and so on. And they are there to support locally people who have ideas, to develop their ideas with a proper mindset. They are there also to train other people. And today we have another 20 people who because it's progressively extended to the complete group, being trained in defense and space and helicopters. I will go rapidly on that. I already mentioned ID Space. With regard to the sourcing of IDs, we have created something which is called the X Lab, which is all again based on the lean startup approach and design thinking approach, a way to not to handle ideas which are popping up here and there, but to create new ideas based on certain on those methodologies. I will go rapidly as well. I will maybe spend more time on this innovation, co-innovation with customers. So it's something that we started also in 2014. The idea is that okay, we know how to design aircraft, we know how to build aircraft. But we have limited knowledge on how the aircraft are operated, and the one who know are the airlines themselves. So let's work together. Let's work together not to test the Airbus ideas in front of airlines, but let's co-create new ideas with them. And we did it in particular with EasyJet, and I can tell you it was really at the same time it brought a lot of good ideas and value, and at the same time it was really challenging for Airbus people, because EasyJet is probably a very good model of an innovative low-cost company. They are very lean, very flat organization, very focused on business value, and so it was at the same time a great opportunity but a big challenge for us. Co-innovation with suppliers may appear as something more conventional. We've been involved in collaborative research projects with our suppliers for long, but here the idea is that they may have ideas which have a high level of maturity, and with our procurement processes and so on, sometimes we are not very agile to take them on board. So we specifically worked with them on that. Startup to partner, when I arrived in 2013, the head of procurement of Airbus told me, why do you want to develop that? Airbus does not buy anything at startups. But 4 years after, we buy things at startups. Not only we buy, but we find business models which help the startup to develop, to make money, and with a good result as well on the Airbus side. So the idea is to find the appropriate business model. Obviously, it's based on case by case. To grow the startup in parallel to the integration of the technology provided by the startup inside Airbus. The ratio is not great. Over the last 3 years, we screened 600 startups, knowing that there was a pre-screening being made by organizations like BPI, the Banque Publique d'Investissement in France, and also investors and so on. Out of 600, we have 10 cases that continue. So the it's a very deep reduction of the numbers. But for these 10 ones, we have really excellent cases. And I will mention one or two of them. Now I will end my talk. I've been too talkative, with a few examples. So AirCam, you probably know it. It's about using drones for the visual inspection of aircraft. Visual inspection, as the world says, it was done by people climbing on top of the aircraft and so on. So it was more or less one day for the visual inspection of an aircraft before delivery. With a drone, you go from 6 hours to 20 minutes. So it has an impact, an enormous impact. The key question was how to translate this into value. And if you reduce the time of inspection before delivery, it means that you can deliver the aircraft one day before, more or less. And the improvement in terms of inventory, one day, is enormous. So this is the so obviously we worked on the development of the solution itself, but a key element was also to convince people with a good business case, and the business case came from this translation of the improvement in inventory and in cash and impact, business impact. Another good example, so this is the first example I will give today on working with a startup. We started 2 years ago to work with a small, it was really a startup in Halifax in Canada, a small company called MTI, who had developed protection for glasses against laser attack. So it was the market target was for them mostly police forces, but they were doing very small things. The technology is very complex. It's about nanostructured materials, and we looked at how to use this technology to protect pilots from those attacks. You need to know that, I do not have the figures for the last year, but 2 years ago, only in the US, there were 14,000 attacks resulting in landing aborted, resulting in some pilots being out of work for a few days because they were injured. So it's a very serious problem for the authorities and for the airlines. So we worked with airlines and pilots to understand what would be good solution. They all said that glasses was not the good solution. So there was the idea of developing a film for the cockpit. And we've been working with this company at the same time on the development of the technology. But the key point was how to make sure that this company will have the opportunity to invest in the technology to do it at an industrial scale. And we found ways to... So Airbus didn't want, it was not Airbus business, so Airbus didn't want to invest directly, but we found a way to finance their development, to help them also getting additional investors. And also we found a way to secure the access to the market through one of our subsidiaries, Satair, which is developing a spare part, also for the certification of the product. So it's just an example that shows that in some cases, in a few cases, we may find a way to develop a small company that has a good idea at the right speed with the necessary ramp up for introducing the technology on the aircraft. Predictive maintenance, I already mentioned it as being a key priority. It's one of the topics that we worked on with EasyJet. And in that specific case, the interest of working with, so it's based on data analytics, data generated by the aircraft. The interest of working with EasyJet was that EasyJet gave us 4 years of data, so we could start playing and identifying what information we could get from the data generated by the aircraft. But mostly we could, working with them, identify what was the source of value for the airline, and we could also work on the development of an appropriate business model that is corresponding to creating value for EasyJet, but also creating a good business case for us. And this work with EasyJet led to the creation of our data lake, Skywise, and we are now offering this solution to our customers. Another thing, so this one will not be in the slide that I will leave. You know that it's not always easy to sell the A380. We have great difficulties, and we worked also on the development of new business models. And one of them is to say, well, the A380, we may have the concept of having two aircraft in one. The main competitor for the 380, in particular in China, is a 777. And we say, if we offer with an A380 the equivalent of a 777 at the same cost, so the 380 for the airline buying the aircraft, it will be the same cost. But on top, the airline will get 300 additional seats with a 46% lower COC cost per seat. Then we have a pretty good rationale for an airline to buy the A380. So the message to the airline is to say, you do not take more buying the A380. It will represent the same financial cost risk as buying a 777. But on top, you may have additional revenues from the fact that you have 300 seats on top. Obviously, it goes through a lot of difficulties in the way you manage it. So it means that in the same aircraft, you have a normal not flight condition, but normal relationship to the passenger, and you have a low cost part of the aircraft. But we are seriously working on it. There are a lot of people interested in going into that direction. In particular, investors, because the idea is also to have a pre-sale of those 300 seats by a third party. So there would be, instead of having one customer for the aircraft, we would have two customers, one buying the normal part of the aircraft and the other one buying the low-cost part of the aircraft. I'm not sure that it would take some time to explain it in more details. Another interesting thing, it's about the cabin. I told you that the cabin is also a domain where we need to be very innovative. It's a concept which was developed by a startup which was hosted for the incubation phase at the Biz Lab in Toulouse. So they have developed a concept where you have a seat which may be either two premium economy seats or one business class seat. It's a wonderful idea, but what is the value of this type of seat? So here we worked with another airline, with Thomas Cook, to understand what is the value of this quick reconfiguration capability of the same aircraft can either offer to the passengers business class seats with an appropriate level of comfort, or for another part of the trip, two premium economy seats. So it's another very interesting topic. We are now close to the final program decision on this one. So you see that sometimes innovation is not about new engines and so on. It may be also things which are very close to normal life, I would say. This one is more technical. It's a good proposal which was developed by some of our engineers. 142 means one nose fuselage for two aircraft. And the idea was to see how we could, you know, that one of the arguments for selling the Airbus family is to say we have a lot of commonality between the different cockpits of our aircraft, between 320, 330 and the other one. Here we are pushing as far as we can the commonality between the different aircraft, including the mechanical part, so having the same mechanical solution for all aircraft and just changing the adaptation. And here we have a pretty good business case as well. And I think that's all. And I think I will spend some time now with questions, if there are questions in the room. I've been too talkative. And this is a clin d'oeil to so a nice Concorde on one of the walls. So, voilà. Thank you.